You are listening to a Clarkesworld Magazine podcast with your host and narrator, Kate Baker. Welcome to July 1st, 2023, issue 202. I hope that you're doing well. I hope that if it is summer where you are, you're keeping cool if it's a little too hot. Or if it's winter where you are, I hope you're keeping warm if it's a little too cold. So if you read this month's editorial, you'll find that Neil is once again making an impassioned plea for readers who are not yet supporting the magazine to please try to do so, or maybe convert if you were going through the Amazon program that was giving us a bunch of income, which is going away, to maybe think about supporting us another way. If I can, with my whole heart, I'd like to implore you to go to patreon.com/Clarkesworld. We're really nervous what the next few months is going to bring, and we can't do this without your help. To those of you who have continued to be steady supporters of the magazine and the podcast, I cannot thank you enough. You are what lets me do my job, lets me tell you a story. With that said, our first story for the month of July is titled Cheaper to Replace and is by Marie Vibbert. Besides selling 70-odd short stories, 40-some poems, and a few comics, Marie Vibbert has been a medieval SCA squire, ridden 17% of the roller coasters in the United States, and has played O-line and D-line for the Cleveland Fusion women's tackle football team. Her work reflects her working-class upbringing in the Rust Belt. She has been translated into French, Czech, Chinese, and Vietnamese. Her work has been called the embodiment of what science fiction should be by the Oxford Culture Review. So, my dear listener, I hope that you can sit back, relax, and let me tell you a story. Hun tried not to look at the greasy fingerprints marking the seams on James' silicone skin. How do you feel, James? Dizzy. He swung his legs against the workbench in perfect imitation of the teen he resembled. But not so much as before. The IT guy mashed his hands in an oily towel. He had thick forearms and a purple skull cap. I replaced the gyroscopic components, but that's not the source of the problem. His balance processing's all screwed up and the gyros are getting banged around. Whatever I put in there is going to wear out the same. Hun didn't like the IT guy. Can he learn to compensate? Well, I don't know. You could hire a specialist to tweak his program. Don't think that there are any out-of-the-box solutions available. He's too old. Honestly, I think the whole processing unit has to go. Otherwise, you're going to have a robot in a wheelchair inside 2 months. He raised his eyebrows at Han, expectant like this was a door he was holding open for her. Han thrust her arms between the IT guy and James. Come on. Going home. Hey. Don't be like that. I did my best work on this kid. Tell you what, we'll buy him off of you for the price of the parts. That's more than you'll get anywhere else. Give you something toward a new one. No, thank you. James took her hand and stood up slowly, not tugging like a real boy would. Han loved his gentleness, even though, on an intellectual level, she knew he was a puppet controlled by libraries of commands. He was a rich family's unwanted toy, dumped on the university as a tax write-off. Han liked to think, though, that he had once been loved, the cherished caregiver to a lonely child, maybe, or a stand-in for never-visiting grandchildren. The IT guy's voice echoed after them in the basement hallway. It'll be cheaper to replace him than to fix him. Anyone will tell you that. A parking garage separated the biomedical research building from the School of Medicine main building. When they were almost halfway across the yellow hashed walk, the light at the entrance of the garage blacked out, followed by a scrape of metal on concrete and the roar of gasoline combustion. Han ducked behind James and prayed Dr. Narayanan was paying attention. It could only be Dr. Narayanan. Dr. Narayanan's legendary 1975 Ford LTD Brougham swung within a foot of them. Its blocky frame rocked like a ship, exposing the wheel wells as it turned into its special double-width parking lot, where it huffed like a weary dragon and settled its sparkly brown carapace to rest. Han was shaking from the near miss. James hugged her. You're all right now, he said. Some routine noticed the facial features of fear or the action of cringing and prompted his soothing words. Her heart broke for the nameless programmers. They didn't have to code that, but they did. The IT department was our last hope, James. Dr. Brescia doesn't want you back. I'm sorry. His hair smelled like her old Barbie doll and clung to her wet cheek. That's okay. A bang echoes through the underground lot, the heavy door of the LTD. Dr. Narayanan strutted by, swinging her car keys on one finger. Get a room, kids, she said in passing. Han stepped back from James and wiped her eyes. She watched Dr. Narayanan step through the door into the biomedical research building. Could Han ever be that confident, that assertive? We'll just have to move you out of the lab. No, Gundo, the administrative assistant for the biochemistry department, didn't even look up from his screen. You guys are always dumping old lab equipment on me. In a week, you won't know how you got along without him. Han glanced at James, who straightened up in his chair and looked, she hoped, helpful and secretarial. Aren't you always saying you need more help? Gundo fell back in his chair, letting it swivel. I need a student who can run printing and scanning for our paper fetishing faculty. James can do that. He learns anything by watching. Gundo rubbed his forehead. You won't regret this. Han jumped to her feet. I didn't say yes. James stood to follow her. Han held out her palm toward him. No, James, stay with Gundo. James took a step. I feel dizzy. I think... James fell forward. Han and Gundo both lurched toward him. He stumbled into the doorframe. There was a crack. Then he was down on his side on the carpet, waving a wedge of the wooden doorframe like a flag of surrender. Gundo stood, arms out as if to catch. He turned from the door to James and back. He has balance issues. It's not... Gundo collected himself. Out. Take it out of here, or I'll call security. Han had to duck under James's swinging elbows to try to help him up. He struck her, hard and heavy. James! I'm sorry. James had a note of panic in his voice. I must balance. I can't. Just stop, James. Be still. He stopped, becoming as stiff as a corpse. Han couldn't lift him, but she dragged him into the hall. Gundo watched without offering to help. When they were clear, he tried to close the door. It wouldn't latch. Gundo tried again. He slammed the door hard, breaking more wood free. Like a curse, he muttered. Now I have to call facilities. Han got two other grad students to help her carry James into his storage closet. She thought he looked relieved when she turned him off. Han sat on the grimy curb in the parking garage. She heard the door behind her open and turned away from it, not wanting whoever it was to see her crying. Hey, a soft woman's voice. Han hunched her shoulders and hoped to turn invisible. Dr. Narayanan sat on the curb next to her. She was wearing tan pants that would easily get dirty. I'm fine. It came out sounding wet. Let me walk you to the counselor's office, Dr. Narayanan said. Han shook her head. Dr. Narayanan tugged her elbow upward. Han turned toward her. You drive that horrible car. Dr. Narayanan straightened. Roberta isn't horrible. I mean, Dr. Narayanan, you have to help me. They're going to sell him for parts. I know he's just a machine, but he's like my little brother, and they want to tear him up for money. Dr. Narayanan's posture relaxed. Ah, you're Dr. Brescia's assistant. You have to know someone who can fix him. You make your antique car run. She shook her head. I'm sorry, kid, but cars aren't robots. It's not the same thing. But could your mechanic at least look at him? Dr. Narayanan stood up and dusted her bottom. Look, if it don't bleed, it don't matter, right? James does matter. She couldn't put it into words, but there was something important in loving an object, putting your heart into the velveteen rabbit or piglet or the sweet doe-eyed silicon boy. Dr. Narayanan gave her a long look. Oh, you're young. You need a couple more years before you can have expensive hobbies like mine. She took a backward step. Counselor's office is still open. She walked away, steps echoing in the wide, low parking garage. Online forums echoed the IT guy's opinion. It was cheaper to replace James than to fix him. 2 years ago, Han's sewing machine had seized up and was only a year old. When she took it back to the store, they had said it would be cheaper to replace it than fix it. Then she took it to an old junk shop near her apartment, and a little old man with gnarled hands and a thick Eastern European accent had said, "Nah, is gear, you see." He popped the case off her sewing machine and replaced the little plastic gear that had seized with a metal one. It took him barely a minute to do so. "You see how they cheap with plastic. Bah, standard size, no charge. Please, it's pleasure, no charge." She bought him a cup of coffee to pay for the repair that was too expensive to make. Han was working on making this into a forum reply. Gundo poked his head into the lab. "Your toy is gone tomorrow." Han stopped typing and stood. "I can get him fixed." Gundo half shrugged. "You keep saying. I have the equipment disposal paperwork all filled out. If he's not doing something useful or gone by tomorrow, I'm filing it." Han followed him into the hall. "Why are you doing this?" "It's my job. Why are you so attached? You do know he's not alive, right?" The door to the administrative office was propped open for repair. When Gundo saw her looking, he raised his eyebrows at her, a silent threat. Han had done the unthinkable. She had pissed off a departmental admin. She'd heard horror stories, dissertations lost, grades removed from records. She had to find a way to make it up to Gundo once she saved James. The junk shop was empty, its sign gone. Through the window, the space looked larger than she remembered, the counter bare. She could still see the drawer the old man had opened, full of little wooden compartments like the change drawer on a cash register. She waited on the stoop, hoping to see the old man if he lived nearby. A police officer walked by, and then he came back. "This isn't a safe neighborhood, miss." Do you know the repairman who used to have a shop here?" His face was unmoving. "You should go home." "Are there any other repair shops like this one was? Does anyone fix anything anymore?"
"I'm not the person to ask about that." The cop looked apologetic, but his hands were on his gun belt. "There's no loitering here."
Han wheeled a lab chair over to the storage closet. She held the chair with one foot hooked behind the wheel while she carefully tipped James forward onto it. The chair slipped away. James dropped like a plank. The crash shook the whole floor. Han froze. No one came. She looked at the chair and back at James. She wasn't strong enough to pick him up. She crouched next to James and switched him on. James rolled onto his back and smiled at her. "Hello, Han. Just give me your hand. Steady. Can you sit up? Now stand." He listed sharply. No. Don't try to balance. Just straighten your legs." With James's help, she got him on the wheelchair. Han was covered in sweat by the time they reached the elevator. Dr. Narayanan opened her apartment door with one hand cradling her phone to her ear. Yeah. Can I call you back?" She stared at Han. "What are you doing here?"
"Sorry to bother you, Dr. Narayanan. James is having trouble with your stairs."
Dr. Narayanan leaned to peer down the apartment stairs. James stood at the bottom, dutifully circling one leg up and back, caught in an endless loop of starting to climb, then being told he was off balance, regaining, starting to climb. Dr. Narayanan leaned back.
"How did you get through the security door?"
"Please help us, Dr. Narayanan. I promise I didn't break anything."
Her glare was leveling, adult, firm.
"Tell me, or I call the cops."
James tried to step again and again. Han sighed.
"I found a hack for your lock online."
"What?"
Dr. Narayanan ran a hand through her hair. She started to move away, then stopped, jabbing a finger at her.
"I'll tell your PI."
"Please don't. I also uploaded the patch so it won't work again, see? I'm helping your security."
"You just..."
Dr. Narayanan closed her eyes.
"I can't begin to unpack all that's wrong with you."
She grinned, like that had been a compliment, and opened her door wider.
"Okay, I'll look at the beast. Let's get him up."
Dr. Narayanan's dining room table was covered in printed schematics and tools. Some strange mechanical things stood at the end, a pillar of cast metal with a fan on top. It looked heavy. Dr. Narayanan set it on a chair before helping Han hoist James onto the table.
Thank you for seeing me, doctor, James said.
He calls the mechanic doctor, Han explained. James, this really is a doctor.
Cute, Dr. Narayanan rubbed her chin. James, can you follow my finger with your eyes?
She passed her hand in front of James and watched his eyeballs track. She bit her lip.
I have no idea if that tells me anything.
Dr. Narayanan stared at James as though his programming were written on the glass surface of his eyes.
He's got a university equipment tag.
She tapped the QR code pinned to his shirt.
The school knows you brought him here, right?
Han tried to force herself to say yes, but she wasn't very good at lying. When more time passed than was natural, Dr. Narayanan said,
I see. It takes a lot of paperwork to throw anything out. If I bring him back working, everyone will be happy.
They're throwing him out. Han felt a tremble in her fists and forced herself to loosen them.
Yes, tomorrow, Gundo said.
Dr. Narayanan tapped her lip.
So the problem is his balance process?
Yes, she shrugged.
Let's try taking it out.
Can you do that?
Sometimes a system can be bypassed. People used to remove their catalytic converter so they could use leaded gas.
He won't be able to tell if he's balanced. But these things have a lot of processing power. We can program him to work around it, like he reacts to your emotional needs without any of his own.
Han didn't like the significant look Dr. Narayanan gave her.
It's not about needs. I customized his reaction to make him more fun to work with. It was a software bundle, actually, RoboQuirks 3.2, but she didn't want Dr. Narayanan thinking she was just some script kitty.
I'm sorry to be so much trouble, James said.
He looked like he was trying to gauge her reaction, like he was worried and wanted her approval. And wasn't that worth a measure of self-delusion? Didn't everyone pretend that fake emotions were real, that the people they worked with were friends, that they were happy to see them? They had a nice day.
I know, it's just programming, Han said.
Customization can ruin a machine, Dr. Narayanan tapped her lip. Have you tried removing the customization code?
But that's his personality.
Dr. Narayanan seemed to study the back of Han's soul.
Do you have any real friends?
Han had to look away.
I mean, it's... We could comment it out for a test. If the first thing doesn't work?
Dr. Narayanan's phone buzzed in her pocket. She pulled it out and looked at it.
All right. Let's give this a shot.
She pressed her screen twice and then set the phone down next to James. Han expected Dr. Narayanan to open James, but instead she got a cable and plugged her phone into him. She frowned at her screen. Han tried to read the frown. The frown deepened. Then a grin broke across Dr. Narayanan's features. She waggled her finger over the phone screen.
Look, see, the motor control doesn't know any better. We replace this routine with a line that says, yep, you're good.
This is pure hatchet hacking. I wish my protein folding program was as simple.
And, okay, let's test that.
Han helped James down from the table. Dr. Narayanan stood next to him, holding her phone close to the jack, the cable sagging. James fell on his face.
Or not, Dr. Narayanan jerked the phone back to save it from following him.
Han rolled up her sleeves and squatted to lift James's shoulders.
Don't worry, I'll get him.
He was so heavy. Dr. Narayanan clucked her tongue and took hold of James. She was strong. Easily, she got him back on the table. She stepped back while they both caught their breath. This was it. This is where she would say it was too much work. It was over. Han would be so alone without James. Her days and weeks were peopleless. Work, computer, read, work. For the first time, she saw how untethered she was. Dr. Narayanan plugged her phone back into James and frowned at the screen, her fingers making quick, subtle motions.
When Ford sold my car, they expected her to last 7 years. You know that?
Companies call it planned obsolescence.
Your James was only intended to last 2 years of that.
But he still works. He was obsolete when the lab got him, and he's lasted years. Well, even companies don't always get what they want. There was something grim in Dr. Narayan's frown as she worked. She unplugged the phone, this time before saying, "Try that." James slipped down from the table himself and walked carefully like an old man, his arms out at his sides. He looked perplexed. Han hovered near him, ready to catch him.
"How do you feel, James?"
James looked at his feet.
"I feel weird, Han. I'm not dizzy, but I don't feel balanced either."
He looked at her, eyes wide.
"Will this be fixed?"
Dr. Narayanan tugged his loose shirt to rights.
"He'll never pirouette again, but he should be able to walk."
Han held James's hand and studied his glassy eyes. He gave her a small, half-embarrassed smile. She hugged him. Dr. Narayanan's phone buzzed again, but she ignored it.
"My LTD spent decades as junk, sitting in a barn in Tennessee. She's got factory paint and a solid frame, but that's all she had when I found her. So yeah, you were right to come to me, I get it. Loving a machine."
"Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Narayanan." Dr. Narayanan shrugged her way out of Han's attempt to hug.
"Get out of here.
And next time he breaks, buy him instead of stealing him." The phone buzzed. This time, Han asked,
"Who keeps calling?"
Dr. Narayanan rolled her eyes and Han thought she wouldn't answer, but she did.
"My kid. She lives with her mom and calls whenever they fight. It sucks. My ex is usually right, and what am I supposed to say?"
Oh, I'm sorry. Dr. Narayanan shrugged. "My ex-wife said it was the car or her." The statement left an awkward, heavy silence. Dr. Narayanan opened the door and gestured for them to leave. Han felt awkward, unable to come up with a response to Dr. Narayanan's personal revelation, but it was kind of her that she stayed by the door as they left, watching in case James fell. He didn't. He made it all the way to the bottom. Leaning against the doorframe, Dr. Narayanan called down,
"If I had it to do over, I wouldn't have chosen the car."
She closed the door gently, but it still felt like a rebuke. Han took James to the bus stop where she paid for an extra ticket.
"You're all right now," James said
and squeezed her hand, exactly the way she knew he would. A programmed response, like writing herself an affirming note. Han returned the hand squeeze.
"What if I can't let go of you when I graduate?"
James tilted his head.
"You're going away?"
"Yes, in 2 or 3 years if I finish my dissertation."
"Don't go," he said.
The bus arrived. His grip on her hand felt too strong. She looked down at it and he let go. His expression turned cheerful, eager.
"Are we going home?"
"Yes, James. Show me how good you can walk to your seat on the bus." And he did. Han followed, feeling the echo of that door closing. She let the space between them widen to feel what it felt like. What are your thoughts on the story? You can leave us a comment if you go to the About Us page at the Clarkesworld Magazine website itself. All of our contact information is listed there. Feel free to send us a message if you'd like. We have a whole slate of stories coming to you for July. I hope you can sit down and listen and come back when you're ready and enjoy the worlds that each of these authors bring your way. So until then, my dear listener, I bid you a very fond and hopefully very temporary farewell.